So good to see you. I'm going to ask you all to stand, and we're going to stand and sing God Bless America.
We are. Maybe.
God bless America. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above, from the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans wide with foam.
Welcome. There's some sadness in this when this is our last weekend with many of you here, but we continue with church. We also continue in ministry here. We have a outreach to the workers at the track, and we still do a meal for them. We have ways that God has given us to serve this community here, especially at the track. So just pray for this ministry as you go back to your home church, and sermon today, I want to inspire you to go back and make a difference in your church. We have the one announcement that I wanted to have us all pray for today is the Midland, Odessa area with the shootings that took place there. That's close to home for all of us. And so we're going to pray for that. And also unspoken prayers. If there's someone on your heart, if there's somebody in your life that you would just like to have that unspoken prayer for, this is a time that we'll lift up those people in your family. It could be a friend, whoever it is. So as the guys come forward for the offering, I'll pray. Father, as we get ready to take offering, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you will just bless the givers, bless all those in this room, whether a little or a lot, Lord. It's an issue of the heart. Lord, we want to be givers for you. I pray for this Midland, Odessa, the victims and families, those that are hurt. I pray that you'll guide these doctors to rescue, to save. But Lord, ultimately in your hand, we give you honor and glory for all that you do. Lord, comfort, we pray. Be with those unspoken prayers that we may be thinking right now of someone in our life. And I pray, Lord, you will touch them, touch us as we pray. I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his Alleluia, 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 prepared to die, and lifted his face up to the sky. He said, "I'm coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which filled his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. Hallelujah. soldier who had used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord said, truly this is Jesus Christ, our Savior. He looked with fear upon his sword and turned his face to Christ his Lord, fell to his knees crying, good morning again. I know that a lot of you who were here last year when we got to worship with Paul Smith, and hopefully those of you that weren't here last year are going to get the biggest blessing of your life. I was blessed enough to have Paul as my worship pastor for many years, and he's an amazing, wonderful man of God. He used to sing with a Christian group called the Imperials, and he still does his own stuff, and he's just pretty amazing, so I hope you enjoy him. Paul Smith.
Good morning. How's everybody? Everybody got enough coffee and donuts? Everybody good? Okay.
Oh, Lord, how you love me, I don't deserve grace on top of grace. It's more than I've asked for, more than I'm worth, grace on top of grace. How sweet the sound, once lost, now found. Heaven, it came down. My sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. Yeah, now Lord, how you love me, I don't deserve grace on top of grace. More than I've asked for, more than I'm worth, grace on top of grace. Hallelujah, I my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, and with your grace on top of grace, with your grace on top of grace.
Thankful to be here. My wife Denise is right here, and we have been looking forward to this ever since we left here last year. We were just thinking, well, we're just, even if we didn't get invited, we were coming back. So we're so glad to do that and be part of this. Got some old ones and new ones for you. We'll mix them in. If you know them, sing along. Yeah, if you don't know them, that's okay. You can just learn them. Trying to get Catherine to sing as much as she can up here with me, so I have a little coaxing. But so. When I'm in the roughest water, I won't go under, I won't drown. When I'm in over my head, I know that you won't let me down. And when I'm broken, there's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good. And even through the deepest valley, you go before me, you are here. The
For I know you'll never leave me. Your love surrounds me, I won't fear. When I'm broken and down to nothing, I know that you are always up to something good. Yet I know that you are always up to something good.
It's okay to clap your hands.
But you make a way, whatever it takes. There's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good. Oh, now through the darkest night, you are on my side. Oh, you are always faithful. Through my fear and doubt, you will lead me out. You are always able. Through the darkest night, you are on my side. You are always faithful. Through my fear and doubt, you will lead me out. I know that you are able. To something good. Yeah. Lord, you make a way, whatever it takes. There's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good.
God always has a plan for us. Amen. Yeah, there you go. Well, I grew up in church. I was there every time the door opened. And, you know, sometimes the door would open and my parents had me there kicking and screaming, but I was there. And my dad was the one that introduced me to the Lord, first of all, and then introduced me to gospel music. And it was very important to him. He was a pretty good singer. And we would get together on Saturday evening. We would have to, you know, I had things to do on Saturday. I had to mow the grass, do a few things. But before I could go do anything, any of us could go do anything on, you know, the weekend with our friend, we had this Saturday afternoon, late Saturday afternoon thing, where we'd get together. We'd watch the Gospel Singing Jubilee. How many remember the Gospel Singing Jubilee? Jubilee. You remember that? It was great, yeah. And some of you don't. Man, that does take you back, doesn't it? We'd watch that. And then we would get together at the piano. My sister would play. I would sing. My other sister, who couldn't sing very well, would just sit there and watch. And my mom would sit on, who couldn't sing either, she would sit on the couch and crochet with her chihuahua, you know? And that was our Saturday evening. We'd do it all the time. But my dad introduced me to a lot of great, great songs and great music. From Stamps Baxter and Stuart Hamlin and Red Foley and all these wonderful guys back then. And it's amazing still now, that many years later, you know, almost, gosh, 50 years ago. I'm younger than I look. So, but we would do those great old songs. And they're still with me today. You know, I'm in the middle of doing a lot of contemporary Christian music, but which I love, but I just don't see any difference. Hey, do you like the old music better than the new music? I said, no, I love it all, because it all has its place. And songs that God gave people 50 years ago, they're still strong and relevant and have great messages as the ones that were just written yesterday. Kind of like this one says, my heart will sing as I pause to remember a heartache here is but a stepping stone upon a road that's leading always upward. This crazy world is not my final home, but unto then my heart will go on singing, and unto then with joy I'll carry on until the day my eyes behold that city. God calls me on. Let me remember that. Anybody remember that song? Yeah, a lot of people do. And this one was one of my dad's favorite. I'm going to get you to sing along here on this one. Here, I mean, let's change the key a little bit. This one goes, the chimes of time ring out the news, another day is through. Someone slipped and fell. Was that someone you may have longed for added strength and your courage to renew? But do not be disheartened, for I have news for you. It is no secret what God can do.
Come on, you guys, sing.
What he's done for others, he'll do for you. With arms wide open, he'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. Oh, there is no night for in his light, you never walk alone. You always feel at home wherever you may go. There is no power can conquer you while God is on your side. Take him at his promise. Don't run away and hide. What he's done for us, he'll do for you. With arms wide open, he'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. With arms wide open, with arms wide open, oh, he'll pardon you. What God can do. Yeah, let's give God a hand for being who he is. My day job right now is I'm a school teacher. I teach at a college in the Dallas area. And all the students that are there are coming to become worship leaders, pastors, worship pastors. So I'm involved with a lot of very talented young people and people who, first and foremost, they just have a real heart for God. They come from all over the world. We have students there. I have the voice students there from Colombia, Germany, wherever. And a lot of them, they're on their own. I mean, they've come because God has called them there. They don't have a tremendous amount of support behind them. at times. They're looking at being able to develop their talents and their skills and their gifts and be able from there go back to their home country to be worship pastors and spread the gospel. But I teach them music. I hopefully teach them a little more about how to sing, you know, and hone those skills that they have. But more often than not with most of them, I just end up being able also hopefully just to speak into their lives. They all come from situations where people have spoken into their lives from a negative standpoint, and they buy into some of the things that people in the world tell them, their friends tell them, even some of their family members tell them, and it's hard because they hear those things and it develops fear, and we all have those fears. But I keep saying, look, get into God's word and don't listen to those things, because those things that are speaking to you, it's whispering in your ear there, they're talking to you about fear. It's not God. God doesn't want you to live that way. We have spirit of love, of power, in 2 Timothy is power and sound mind. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. We don't have that fear because we have Jesus Christ in our lives. So we continue to share that with them and just realize that what they're listening to is a lie. A song about that says, when he told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be. Fear, he is a liar. He will take your breath, stop you in your steps. Fear, he is a liar. He will rob your rest, steal your happiness. So cast your fear in the fire. Cause fear, he is a liar. When he told you you were trouble, wish you should be alone. When he told you you should run away, you'll never find a home. When he told you you were dirty, that you should be ashamed. When he told you you could be the one that grace could never change. Oh, fear, he is a liar. He will rob your rest, stop you in your steps. Fear, he is a liar. He will eat your breath, steal your happiness. Oh, cast that fear in the fire, cause fear, he is a liar. Let your fire fall and cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, Lord, and cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall and cast out all I fear. Let your fire fall, your love is all I feel. Oh, fear, he is a liar. He will rob your breath and stop you in your steps. Rob your rest and steal your happiness. Cast your fear in the fire. Cause fear, he is a liar. Cast your fear in the fire. Cause fear, he is a liar. a liar. So, as believers and the people who really know what love is through Jesus Christ, and we're the ones that we have to speak those words of love and encouragement, and that's all we have to do. We just have to do that with what Jesus gave us. This is a song that is based on the last words that Christ spoke. One of my favorites. Love this song. And Catherine's going to sing along with this one. Okay.
All right. Well, I do what I'm told. So,
okay, we'll just call an audible here, okay? We'll just call things at the line. I sometimes just take requests. You get to play Stump the Band. So, okay, so I'll do this one and one more, okay? Then I'll get out of your hair. This is a request.
Well, it was battered and scarred, and the auctioneer felt it hardly worth his while to waste much time on an old violin, but he held it up with a smile. Said, it sure ain't much, but it's all that's left. I guess we ought to sell it too. Who start the bids on this old violin? Just one more and we'll be through. He cried, one, give me $1. Who make it two? Only $2. Who make it three? $3 twice, now that's a good price. Who's got a bid for me? Raise up your hand now, don't wait no longer, cause this auction's about to end. Who's got four, maybe $1 more to bid on this old violin? The air was hot and the people stood round. The sun was setting low. And from the back of the crowd, a gray-haired man, he came forward and he picked up the bow. He wiped the dust from that old violin. He tightened up the strings. And he played them a melody, clear and sweet, as sweet as any angel could sing. The music stopped. The auctioneer, with a voice that was quiet and low, he said, now, hey, what are my bids on this old violin? He held it up with a bow. He cried, one, give me 1,000. Who'll make it two? Only 2,000. Who'll make it three? And 3,000 twice, now that's a good price. Who's got a bid for me? The people cried out. They said, hey, what made the change? Because we don't understand. The auctioneer stopped. He just said with a smile. He said it was the touch of the master's hand. And many a man with his life out of tune, battered and scarred with sin, auctioned cheap to a thankless world, oh, much like that old violin. But the master comes, and the foolish crowd, they never quite understand the worth of a soul and the chains that is brought by the touch of the master's hand. He cried, hey, one, give me 1,000, who'll make it two? Only 2,000, who'll make it three? 3,000 twice, now that's a good price. Who's got a bid for me? Well, the people cry out, they say, what makes the change? Because we need to understand. The auctioneer stops, he just says with a smile, it was the touch of the master's hand. And another songwriter just said it this way, like earlier, said, amazing grace, how sweet the sound, and saved a wretch like me. Blind. Now I see the people cry out, what makes the change? We want to understand. Auctioneer stops, he'll just say with a smile, it was the touch of the master's hand. Dreamed I went to heaven, and you were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing, but then someone called your name. You turned and you saw this young man. He was smiling as he came. He said, friend, you may not know me. But then he said, but wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every week you'd say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. So thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Oh, thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Then another man, he stood before you and he said, remember the time a missionary came to church? Oh, his pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took that gift that you gave, and that's why I'm here today. Well, thank you for giving to the Lord. Oh, I have a life that is changed. Yes, thank you for giving to so glad you gave. One by one they came, far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. All the little things that you had done, all the sacrifices made, unnoticed here on earth, but in heaven now proclaimed. And they tell me up in heaven, you're not supposed to cry. But I am almost certain there were tears in your eyes. As Jesus took your hand, he stood before the Lord. He said, child, now look around you, 'cause great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. So glad you gave. Yes, just thank you for giving to the Lord. Oh, I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. I am so glad you gave. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain. Be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords. Today.
Lord bless you.
Paul, thank you. Thank you for teaching young men to go out and lead worship, lead churches, lead people to Christ, exactly what you were singing about, building. You know, we build each other up. This building, an architectural building, is put together in a certain way to function. We have the kitchen where we serve the meals. We have the place in the back for the kids' classes. We have this place to worship. We have a place of prayer for a prayer room. It's designed and intended for people to gather. As Christians, we're designed in a particular way. God has designed each of us uniquely to serve him, to minister for him. In Ephesians 2:10, it says, "For we are his creation, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time so that we could walk in them." He's prepared something for each one of you. He's prepared a way for you to serve him, to bless others, to bring others closer to him, for us to contribute, to make a difference in this world. And I pray you feel that. I pray that as you come to this chapel, as you're around the racetrack, that you come in contact with people and you have that opportunity to share. I had a great experience yesterday. We were, the Christian Services got a bunch of pears. They were like overrun with pears, cases of them. And they called me up and said, "Can you do anything with these pears?" And I certainly can do something with pears. We loaded them up on golf carts and we're passing them out. And a young man was with me. What wisdom comes from young men. He said to me, he said, "Daryl, when these guys come out of the barn, they have such a big smile on their face. And you know, you could think that's because they're getting a pear. But you know, there's something more than a pear. There's something that when we give to one another, when we give to somebody, whether they're in need or not, we can bring a smile to their face and give them a taste of Christ himself. When he touches us, when he puts that joy in our hearts, we're filled and we're made for that. He shaped us for that. In Job, it says, "God, your hand shaped me and made me." He made us for a specific purpose, and that's to serve one another, to love one another. Love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. And when you do that, you're hitting on all cylinders. You're becoming what he's made you to be, Because you can take that message, the message that begins in love, as I spoke last week, and put it into action. I've always been told love is a word, is a adverb, you know. Guys, we have a hard time with that, don't we? I can say I love you, but man, don't make me do anything. But that's what God is after. God is saying, you know, don't just say you love somebody, do something. Do something with what you have, whether it's something in your pocket to give, whether it's a pair to hand out. But God will use whatever you have, whether little or much, to make a difference in somebody's life. He will change them. Rick Warren, where I got this material from, out of his book, That Purpose-Driven Life, it says, what matters is not how long you live, but how you live. What matters is not the duration of your life, but the donation of your life. The Bible says we're created to serve, we're saved to serve, we're gifted to serve, we're shaped to serve, we're commanded to serve God back, and He's made us that way. If you want to be frustrated, just sit at home and be selfish. And you'll never get that smile. You'll never have the satisfaction of seeing somebody return that smile out of pure gratitude. Or like the song said, somebody that shared the gospel with them, thank you. Thank you for sharing with me. You brought me into the kingdom. And you can think of who may have done that for you. It was somebody exercising a spiritual gift, having a heart of passion. Another person told me they were a life coach, and we were talking, and she said, you know, I just have a passion to do this. It's not about the money. I have a passion to do it. And that's where it begins. It begins with that passion, which is love. It begins with a love for others and a love to see somebody rise up, to see God change somebody's heart and turn them into someone new that will drive you. It will give you a passion for ministry that's not dictated by dollars. It's dictated by lives changed and knowing that God is using you. Rick Warren goes on to say, God designed each of us so that there would be no duplication in the world. No one has the exact mix of factors that make you unique. This means no one on earth will ever be able to play the role that God has planned for you. He's got that specific purpose. You're one of a kind. Now, I've been told that before, and it had a different inflection on it. But you are. We are one of a kind. And He uses personalities, different personalities. I've been told before, Daryl, I can't believe you get up there and preach because, you know, the things you say when you're out off the pulpit just don't come out right all the time. And maybe they don't hear, but God has changed your ears to hear it correctly. But God is using you, and He'll use me in the same way. Luke 17:33 says, whoever tries to keep his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life will preserve it. It's a great truth in Scripture. When I came to New Mexico, I thought, I'm just going to be a hermit. And I tried to stay away from town as much as possible. But God was always after me, and He got me involved with a church where they had kids going to camp, and I'd take them to camp, and I just got involved. And that's what this is about today, to get involved. Don't sit back and say, hey, I just don't want to be a part. But get involved to where God uses you. You can see Him using you. E. Stanley Jones says, grace binds you far stronger cords than the cords of duty or obligation can bind you. Grace is free. But when you take it, you're bound forever to the giver and bound to catch the spirit of the giver. Like produces like. Grace makes you gracious, and the giver makes you give. God, when He enters into us through His Son, Christ Jesus, He transforms us to be givers, givers of ourselves, givers to see a person in need and have compassion for that, to move in areas of your life you've never thought possible, to love as you'd never thought possible, to get rid of that self-centered nature, because you'll just find frustration there. But when you walk close to Him, people get to know Him. You bring Him to them. You bring Christ to the situation. You bring Christ to the heart. Stearns goes on to say, being a Christian requires more than just having a personal and transforming relationship with God. It also entails a public and transforming relationships with the world. If your personal faith in Christ has no outward expression, then your faith has a hole in it. We can come to church and we can learn all we can, and we can be takers, so to speak, in Christ's kingdom. We can just be always being filled but never giving out. But you're going to only be filled to a certain point. But when you begin to give out, when the message of Christ reaches you and you begin to give that out, to give out his love and his grace and his kindness and compassion, you're filled more and more. Your life will never be empty. It'll be abundant. Today, people are asking, is Christianity true? You know how it's revealed? Through you and I. The truth of Christianity is when people see Christ living in you, working through you, loving through you, giving to our communities and to the world around us. There's some points, and I'm going to run through them quickly. Don't overlook small opportunities to bless others. Sometimes we get overwhelmed with the need in this world, with hunger, poverty. But like I said last week, that little boy that just handed out blankets to the homeless, don't look at how big the projects are, but start. Just start giving. God will take that. He'll give cheer to those around. You can sponsor a child. You can visit somebody that's lonely. Go to the hospital. Visit somebody in a hospital. Show that kindness and encouragement to others. Never give up on doing good. You know, in Corinthians it says, let nothing, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. You know, Christ, when he said, when you give a cup of water, he talks in Mark 9:41, he says, I tell you the truth, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name because you belong to Christ will certainly not lose his reward. There is a reward when we serve one another. Significance, not prominence. Sometimes we think things that are just given a lot of attention, those prominent things, are things we should be doing for Christ, but God is looking at those small things. The second thing is, don't worry about limitations. Many times we think, boy, how can God use me? I don't have this talent. But it's not about us, it's about him. It's about being faithful to him, and he'll use you, just like that violin, dusty violin. The master's hand made a sweet sound. Don't worry. Let him give you those capabilities. Let him turn you from, he tells us that we're jars of clay, to show us his all-surpassing power out of Corinthians as well. He will show his power through you, through that jar of clay which he calls us. Brian Wilkerson, a great writer, he says, God's not looking for sterling silver teapots. He's looking for rough and tumble clay pots. Do you want to be that clay pot? Do you want to be the kind that's not tucked away somewhere in a china cabinet, but one that's out there getting dirty in this world, passing out pears or doing whatever God calls you to do? It's that willing heart. The third thing is not to look for a receipt, so to speak, not to look for a reward for what you do. Jesus in 25:37-39 of Matthew says, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go visit you? The point is, these sheep that Jesus was talking about, they weren't looking for a reward. They were just doing what God had called them to do. And then he came and said, when you do this, you're doing it for me. They had the right attitude when they were doing things for the Lord. And we shouldn't exclude anybody. That's the fourth point. We shouldn't exclude anybody. We should be open to serve anybody. Somebody who might not be able to pay you back. And in this room, there's probably many stories. People in your own family. People that you've come across in difficult situations that they brought upon themselves, and we go, let them learn themselves. But God doesn't call us to do that. He doesn't call us to push away someone of a different race or some religion that doesn't believe Christ is God. He says, these are all my children. Show them Christ. Show them my son. Don't be exhausted in doing good. There was a wedding in Australia, and the couple, they were on a cliff overlooking the ocean. And a lady, not even part of the wedding party, fell off the cliff into the ocean below. The husband was an avid swimmer and dove in and rescued her right off that cliff. And as he was bringing her to shore, the bride went down the path, and she was a nurse, gave her CPR. When the paramedics came, they said, boy, having both those people there, you sure are one lucky woman. And she said, no, they are givers. They gave of their time, even though they were in a wedding, their wedding, to come and rescue me. Bet you those were quite some wedding pictures, don't you think? We're always on duty, folks. And the last thing, bless others. Bless others. As we bless Jesus by what we do, every human being, he loves his children. When someone does something for your children or your grandchild, doesn't it speak to you about that person? Aren't you glad when you see someone reach out to your kids? Just think of how God feels when we reach one of his own. When we give that love to someone, a hungry child or someone in need, someone in pain or somebody that's cold, we give and it puts a smile on God's face. As I close, like I said at the beginning, we've talked a lot about worship and discipleship this summer. We've talked about the life of Christ living through us. But it's when he's working through you that you will see the greatest change in your life as you serve him. Let's have a time of prayer. Catherine, are you going to come sing? We'll do one song, and as we have our heads bowed, I want you to think about ways that you can serve. Ways that you can go back home to your church, or if you're local here in this church, that we can serve one another with his love. And then I'll close with the benediction, one verse. Just bow your heads.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to
one by name, Lord. Our names are written on your hand. Lord, we just ask you to lift each one up, Lord, in this room. I pray that you'll work in our hearts through this winter time, that we'll grow closer to you, be fired up, Lord, to serve you in our local church. Lord, we just pray for this whole weekend of racing, Lord, that we'll have safe racing, the best in the world. But Lord, most of all, that hearts will be changed by your message, Lord, the gospel message, that you lived and you died and you rose again that those who believe that, Lord, you dwell within them. You come to save and set us free. We ask all this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.